Good evening and welcome. We are in for a really great treat today to hear the remarkable writer Maryse Conde read from her work for us this evening. This event is co-sponsored by our Penn Open Book Committee and the Small Press Center. Just want to tell you just a little tiny bit about the Open Book Committee. My name is Elizabeth Nunez, and I chair that committee, the Open Book Committee. And what we want to do, what we try to do in the Open Book Committee, is to promote works by and about writers of color, Asian writers, African American writers, Caribbean writers, Latin American writers. And so there are various events that we sponsor in trying to reach that goal. And the Small Press Center joined us in this evening, and they generally welcome collaborative events with us. So we are grateful to them, and especially to Karen Taylor, who was a little under the weather this afternoon and couldn't stay with us now. I want to introduce you to Natasha Gordon, who basically coordinates the programs for the Penn Open Book Committee, and Kevin Brown, who is back there, who also helps. Kevin works as an intern and a volunteer for the program. Natasha, where are you? Yeah.
Good evening. I just want to thank everybody for coming. This is a wonderful event. Not only do we have the special pleasure of hearing Maryse Conde read, but we also have Jayne Cortez come to do our introduction. I will be giving you a little bit more information at the end of the program, but I just wanted to let you know that we will have one other event this year for the Open Book Committee, which is on June 15th, and it will be at the Brooklyn Museum of Art. I will let you know who the readers are at the end of the program, but I just wanted to let you know so you guys can save the date. I'll be very short. I just want to thank you once again for coming and enjoy the evening.
Jayne Cortez has been just really kind enough and generous enough, and really, when we approached her with this idea, was just really very receptive to it and welcomed the idea, the opportunity to introduce Maryse Conde this evening. Jayne Cortez was born in Arizona and grew up in California and currently lives in New York City. She's the author of 10 books of poems and has performed her poetry with music on 9 recordings. Her voice is celebrated for its political, surrealistic, dynamic innovations in lyricism and visceral sound. Jayne Cortez has presented her work and ideas at universities, museums, and festivals in Africa, Asia, Europe, South America, and the Caribbean, and the United States. Her poems have been translated into many languages and widely published in anthologies, journals, and magazines. She's the recipient of several awards, including the Arts International, the National Endowment for the Arts, the International African Festival Award, the Langston Hughes Award, the American Book Award. Her most recent book is Jazz Fan Looks Back, published by Hanging Loose Press, and her latest CD recording with her band Fire Spitters is Taking the Blues Black Home, produced by Harmelodic and Verve Records. Jayne Cortez is the director of the film Yari Yari, the organizer of the 1999 International Symposium Slave Roots, The Long Memory, and president of the Organization of Women Writers of Africa. She is on screen in the films Women in Jazz and Poetry in Motion. Jayne Cortez.
Good evening. Thank you. Maryse Conde was born on the French Caribbean island of Guadeloupe, studied and received her doctorate in Caribbean literature from the Sorbonne in Paris, France. She is the author of 7 novels, all originally published in French and all exploring the existential legacy of African diaspora, with special regard for the aftermath of slavery and colonialism. Maryse Conde has been the recipient of many awards, including Le Grand Prix Littéraire de la Femme, Le Grand Prix de l'Académie Française, a Guggenheim Fellowship, and the Prix Yersinia, awarded in 1999 for her memoir, Tales from the Heart. She is chair of the Center for French and Francophone Studies at Columbia University and lives in New York City with her husband, Richard Philcox, who is the translator of her work. One of my earliest encounters with Maryse was when the Organization of Women Writers of Africa was trying to organize Yari Yari, Black Women Writers and the Future International Conference at New York University in 1997. And we met at B. Smith's restaurant and for lunch and for advice on how to do this conference. And Maryse gave us many suggestions, and they were very thoughtful and very, very useful. We also met in her homeland of Guadeloupe at the Root of the Slave Conference in 1998. She was gracious enough to introduce us to the culture and people of Guadeloupe. And in return, I take great pleasure in introducing to you in New York City, my dear friend, the wonderful, brilliant writer, Maryse Conde.
Good evening, very happy to see you tonight. But before I read from the book in French, a bit in French, I'm going to tell you more about it. It is a childhood memoir. You know, it is very difficult to write a childhood memoir, but we had something in mind, the publisher and myself. There is a set idea about childhood in the Caribbean. For example, there is that movie that everybody has seen, which is Sugarcane Alley. And when you speak of a childhood in the French Caribbean, you have an idea of poverty, lack of everything, somebody fighting to survive. But some of us, I mean, in the Caribbean, especially in the French Caribbean, we are lucky not to have the fight for survival. We belong to families where the problem of the material problems have been solved. But anyway, we suffer from something which is even more complicated. The question, who are we? Are we French? Because our countries are French Overseas Department. Are we Black people of African descent? So, I mean, nobody ever comes forward to give us a clear answer. And we have to sort of struggle on our own and find a way to define ourselves. So in the memoir, Tales from the Heart, I was trying to explain how it was difficult for a girl born in Guadeloupe, born in such a family, to discover exactly who she is, to come to terms with so many elements very contradictory in herself, and to come forward and say, I am Maryse Conde. So it is a story of a kind of awakening, a coming of to age. And so I'm going to read to you in French the first chapter. Why am I going to read in French? Because I hope that in the audience some people understand French. We have a very complicated relationship with French. It is a colonial language, of course. But we came to love that colonial language. We come to consider that language as the basis, the root of our writing. So it is very difficult for me to hear my work in translation. Of course, I do love the translation, especially as they come from Richard. who's my husband. But anyway, in French, there is a voice. It seems to me that there is a voice which is a bit different. So the first chapter I'm going to read from is a kind of presentation of my family, my father, my mother, and my numerous brothers and their sisters in a place which was a place that they love dearly, that is to say Paris. Because in fact, Guadeloupe for them was a kind of second homeland. The first one, the one they were very fond of, very proud of course, was France, and Paris was a kind of the heart of culture and civilization. So I'm going to read, don't be afraid, just the two first pages, and after you will hear the book in English. Portrait de famille. Si quelqu'un avait demandé à mes parents leur opinion sur la Deuxième Guerre mondiale, ils auraient répondu sans hésiter que c'était la période la plus sombre qu'ils aient jamais connue. Non pas à cause de la France coupée en deux, des camps de Drancy ou d'Auschwitz, de l'extermination de 6 millions de Juifs, ni de tous ces crimes contre l'humanité qui n'ont pas fini d'être payés, mais parce que pendant 7 interminables années, ils avaient été privés de ce qui comptait le plus pour eux, leur voyage en France. Comme mon père était un ancien fonctionnaire et ma mère en exercice, ils bénéficiaient régulièrement d'un congé en métropole avec leurs enfants. Pour eux, la France n'était nullement le siège du pouvoir colonial. C'était véritablement la mère patrie. Et Paris, la ville lumière qui seule donnait de l'éclat à leur résistance. Ma mère nous chargeait la tête de description des merveilles du carreau du Temple et du marché Saint-Pierre, avec en prime la Sainte-Chapelle et Versailles. Mon père préférait le musée du Louvre et le dancing La Cigale, où il allait en garçon se dégourdir de la chambre. Aussi, dès le mi-temps de l'année, nous reprions avec délice le paquebot qui devait nous amener au port du Havre, première escale sur le chemin du retour au pays d'adoption. J'étais la petite dernière. Un des récits mythiques de la famille concernait ma naissance. Mon père portait haut et droit ses 63 ans. Ma mère venait de fêter ses 43 ans. Quand elle ne vit plus son sang, elle crut au premier signe de la ménopause. Elle courut trouver son gynécologue, le docteur Mélas, qui l'avait accouché 7 fois. Après l'avoir examiné, il partit d'un grand éclat de rire. « Ça m'a fait tellement honte », racontait ma mère à ses amis, « que pendant les premiers mois de ma grossesse, c'était comme si j'étais infirmière. J'essayais de cacher mon ventre derrière ma mère. » Elle avait beau ajouter, en me couvrant de baisers, que sa grâce à bouillot était devenue son petit bâton de vieillesse, en entendant cette histoire, j'éprouvais à chaque fois le même chagrin, je n'avais pas été désirée. Aujourd'hui, je me représente le spectacle peu courant que nous offrions assis aux terrasses du quartier latin dans le Paris morose de l'après-guerre. Mon père, ancien séducteur au maintien avantageux, ma mère, couverte de son pied-bûche créole, leurs 8 enfants, mes sœurs, paris comme des chasses, mes frères, adolescent, l'un d'eux déjà à sa première année de médecine, et moi, bambine, outrageusement gâtée, l'esprit précoce pour son âge. Leur plateau en équilibre sur la hanche, les garçons de café voltaient autour de nous, remplis d'admiration comme autant de mouches à miel. Ils lâchaient invariablement, en servant les diablomantes. Qu'est-ce que vous parlez bien le français? Mes parents recevaient le compliment sans broncher, ni sourire, et se bornait à hocher du chef. Une fois que les garçons avaient tourné le dos cependant, ils nous prenaient à témoin. Pourtant, nous sommes aussi français qu'eux, soupira mon père. Plus français qu'eux, renchérissait ma mère avec violence. So, who's coming next? Elisabeth or... Oh, OK. So, more? I finish? But it is French. OK. Elle ajoutait en guise d'explication, nous sommes plus instruits, nous avons de meilleures manières, nous lisons davantage. Certains d'entre eux n'ont jamais quitté Paris alors que nous connaissons le Mont-Saint-Michel, la Côte d'Azur et la Côte Basque. Il y avait dans cet échange un pathétique qui, toute jeune que j'étais, me navrait. C'était d'une grave injustice qui se plaignait. Sans raison, les rôles s'inversaient. Les ramasseurs de pourboire en gilet noir et tablier blanc se hissaient au-dessus de leurs généreux clients. Ils possédaient tout naturellement cette identité française qui, malgré leur bonne mine, était niée, refusée à mes parents. Et moi, je ne comprenais pas en vertu du quoi ces gens orgueilleux, contents d'eux-mêmes, notables d'un pays, rivalisaient avec les garçons qui les servaient. Un jour, je décide d'en avoir le cœur net. Comme chaque fois que j'étais dans l'embarras, je me tournais vers mon frère, Alexandre, qui s'était lui-même baptisé Sandrino pour faire plus américain. Premier de sa classe, les poches bourrées de billets doux de ses gamines, Sandrino me faisait l'effet du soleil dans le ciel. Bon frère, il me traitait avec une affection protectrice, mais je ne me consolais pas d'être seulement sa petite sœur. Oubliée, dès qu'une taille de guêpe passait aux alentours ou qu'un match de football débutait. Est-ce qu'il y comprenait quelque chose au comportement de nos parents? Pourquoi en fiait-il si fort des gens qui, de leur propre aveu, ne leur arrivaient pas à la cheville? Nous habitions un appartement au rez-de-chaussée dans une rue tranquille du 6e arrondissement. Ce n'était pas comme à la pointe où nous étions vissés, cadencés à la maison. Nos parents nous autorisaient à sortir autant que nous le voulions et même à fréquenter des autres enfants. En ce temps-là, cette liberté m'étonnait. Je compris plus tard, bien plus tard, qu'en France, mes parents n'avaient pas peur que nous nous mettions à parler le créole ou que nous prenions goût au gros cas comme les petits nègres de la pointe. Je me rappelle que ce jour-là, nous avions joué à chat perché avec les blondinets du premier étage et partager un goûter de fruits secs, car Paris connaissait encore les pénuries. Pour l'heure, la nuit commençait de transformer le ciel en passoire étoilée. Nous nous apprêtions à rentrer avant qu'une de mes sœurs passe la tête par la fenêtre et nous appelle. Les enfants, papa et maman vous ont dit de venir manger. Pour me répondre, Sandrino s'adossa contre une porte cochère. Sa figure joviale, encore marquée par l'enfance, les joues rondes, se couvrit de masques sombres. Sa voix s'alourdit. T'occupe pas, laissa-t-il tomber. Papa et maman sont une paire d'aliénés. Aliénés? Qu'est-ce que ce mot voulait dire? Je n'osais pas poser de questions. Ce n'était pas la première fois que j'entendais Sandrino faire des jeux avec mes parents. Ma mère avait accroché au-dessus de son lit une photo découpée dans ébony. On y admirait une famille noire américaine de 8 enfants comme la nôtre, tous médecins, avocats, ingénieurs, architectes, bref, la gloire de leurs parents. Cette photo inspirait les pires rêveries à Sandrino, qui, ignorant qu'il mourrait avant d'avoir seulement commencé sa vie, jurait qu'il deviendrait un écrivain célèbre. Il me cachait les premières pages de son roman, mais il avait l'habitude de me réciter des poèmes qui me laissaient perplexe parce que, d'après lui, la poésie ne se comprenait pas. Je passais la nuit suivante à me tourner et à me retourner dans mon lit, au risque de réveiller ma sœur, Thérèse, qui dormait au-dessus de ma tête. C'est que je chérissais très fort mon père et ma mère. C'est vrai, leurs cheveux grisonnants, les rides sur leur front, ne me faisait pas plaisir. J'aurais préféré deux jeunesses. Ah, qu'on prenne ma mère pour ma grande sœur, comme cela arrivait à ma bonne amie Yveline quand sa maman l'accompagnait au catéchisme. C'est vrai, j'étais à l'agonie quand mon père émaillait sa conversation de phrases en latin qu'on pouvait trouver à la fin du dictionnaire Larousse. Verba volent, scripta manent, carpe diem, pater familias, deus ex machina. Je souffrais surtout des bas, deux tons trop clairs pour sa peau bon teint que ma mère portait malgré la chaleur. Mais je connaissais la tendresse du fond de leur cœur et je savais qu'ils s'efforçaient de nous préparer ce qu'ils croyaient être la plus belle des existences. En même temps, j'avais trop de froid dans mon frère pour douter son jugement. À sa mine, au ton de sa voix, je sentais qu'aliéner cette parole mystérieuse désignait une qualité d'affection humaine, honteuse comme la bénorragie, peut-être même mortelle comme la fièvre typhoïde, qui l'année passée avait emporté des quantités de gens à la pointe. À minuit, à force de tourner et retourner tous ces indices entre eux, je finis par bâtir une ensemble de théories. Une personne aliénée est une personne qui cherche à être ce qu'elle ne peut pas être parce qu'elle n'aime pas ce qu'elle est, elle n'aime pas être ce qu'elle est. À 2 heures du matin, au moment de prendre sommeil, je me fis le serment, confus, de ne jamais devenir une aliénée. En conséquence, je me réveillai une toute autre petite fille. D'enfant modèle, je devins répliqueuse et raisonneuse. Comme je ne savais pas très bien ce que je voulais, il me suffisait de questionner tout ce que mes parents proposaient. Une soirée à l'opéra, pour écouter les trompettes d'Aïda ou les clochettes de l'Acmé, une visite à l'orangerie pour admirer les nymphéas, ou tout simplement une robe, une paire de souliers, des nœuds pour mes cheveux. Ma mère, qui ne brillait pas par la patience, ne lésinait pas sur les taloches. 20 fois par jour, elle s'exclamait. Mon Dieu, qu'est-ce qui est passé dans le corps de cet enfant-là? Une photo prise à la fin de ce séjour en France nous montre au jardin du Luxembourg mes frères et sœurs en randonnant, mon père moustachu, vêtu d'une part du sud à revers de fourrure, façon pelisse, ma mère souriant de tous ses dents de perles, ses yeux en amande étirés sous son toupet gris. Entre ses jambes, moi, maigrichonne, enlaidie par cette mine boudeuse et excédée que je devais cultiver jusqu'à la fin de l'adolescence, jusqu'à ce que le sort qui frappe toujours trop durement les enfants ingrats fasse de moi une orpheline à 20 ans. Depuis, j'ai eu tout le temps de comprendre le sens du mot « aliéné » et surtout de me demander si Sandrino avait raison. Mes parents étaient-ils des aliénés? Sûr et certain, ils n'éprouvaient aucun orgueil de leur héritage africain. Ils l'ignoraient. C'est un fait. Au cours de ses 6 jours en France, mon père ne prit jamais le chemin de la rue des écoles où la revue « Présence africaine » sortait du cerveau d'Alain Diop. Comme ma mère, il était convaincu que seule la culture occidentale vaut la peine d'exister et se montrait reconnaissant envers la France qui leur avait permis de l'obtenir. En même temps, ni l'un ni l'autre n'éprouvaient le moindre sentiment d'infériorité à cause de leur couleur. Ils se croyaient les plus brillants, les plus intelligents. Ils se croyaient la preuve par 9 de l'avancement de leur race de grand nègre. Est-ce cela être aliéné?
I'm just going to do a little bit of it.
Okay.
I absolutely love this book. I'm just going to read just a little bit of what she read in English, and then Richard and I are going to read a little excerpt from the book. So just for the English speakers. If someone had asked my parents what they thought about the Second World War, they would no doubt have replied it was the darkest period they had ever known. Not because France was cut in two, or because of the camps in Drancy or Auschwitz, or the extermination of 6 million Jews, or all those crimes against humanity that are still being paid for, but because for 7 long years they were deprived of what meant the most to them, their trips to France. Since my father was a former civil servant and my mother was still working as a teacher, they were regularly entitled to a paid vacation from their home in Guadeloupe to the metropole with their children. For them, France was in no way the seat of colonial power. It was truly the mother country, and Paris, the city of light, that lit up their lives. My mother would cram our heads with descriptions of the marvels of the Carreau du Temple and the Saint-Pierre Market, throwing in as a bonus the Sainte-Chapelle and Versailles. My father preferred the Louvre and the Cigale dance hall, where as a bachelor he had gone to get his juices flowing. So we were only halfway through 1946 before they set sail again in sheer delight on the steamship that was to carry them to Le Havre, the first stop on their way back to their country of adoption. I was the very youngest. One of the family's mythical stories was the circumstances of my birth. My father was still going strong at 63. My mother had just celebrated her 43rd birthday. When she missed her period, she thought it was the first sign of menopause and rushed over to her gynecologist, who had delivered her 7 times. After examining her, he burst out laughing. I was so ashamed, my mother would tell her friends, that during the first few months I walked around like an unmarried mother and tried to cover myself up. However much she showered me with kisses, saying that her little latecomer had become like her walking stick in her old age, I had the same feeling every time I heard this story. I had not been desired. Today I can imagine that the somewhat unusual sight we must have made, sitting in the sidewalk cafes of the Latin Quarter in a gloomy post-war Paris, my father, a former Don Juan, still looking good for his age, my mother decked out with lavish Creole jewelry, their 8 children, my sisters, eyes lowered, rigged out like shrines, my teenage brothers, one of them already in his first year at medical school, and me, a spoiled, precocious little brat. Their trays balanced on their hips, the garçons de café would hover around us admiringly like honeybees, setting out the diabolos menthe. Month. They never failed to come out with, "You speak excellent French, you know." My parents bore the compliment without turning a hair or smiling, merely a nod of the head. Once the garçon had gone, they turned to us as witnesses. "Yet we are as much French as they are," my father sighed. And then, because I am going to ask Maryse this question at the end, she has a section called The Bluest Eye. And of course, I immediately think of Toni Morrison, so it's a short section, and I'll read Her Bluest Eye. And just excuse my pronunciation of the French places. The Rue Alexandre Isaac, where our house was located, began a little further up from the Place de la Victoire, the very center of La Pointe's social life, and vanished into a respectable working class neighborhood. Not at all like the Vatable Canal district with its open ditches and shacks. It was a venerable street inhabited by all established families, but also by those of modest means, yet with impeccable manners. My parents had moved there a few months before I was born, when the house on the Rue Conde had become too small for the growing number of children, but above all, because it no longer corresponded to their new standing. My father had just been decorated with the Légion d'honneur, goodness knows why, and my mother had proudly sewn red thread on every one of his buttonholes. "Monsieur Bocolon," as someone had asked him, "what's that red on your jacket?" she liked to repeat, holding her sides with laughter. The houses on Rue Alexandre Isaac were built of wood with identical frames, yet there were subtle differences, such as the shade of red of the zinc roof, a fresh coat of paint, or the splash of flowers along the balconies that distinguished one from the other. A family of 12 children, the Driscolls, occupied a vast corner house, badly maintained, with a patch roof and an empty balcony without bougainvillea or hibiscus. Whenever they met my parents, there would be a polite good morning or good evening, but they never mixed. Deep down, my parents felt superior to them. Monsieur and Madame Driscoll were obscure civil servants without class, who didn't even own a car. It was rumored they were odd, not like other people, and they were mulattoes. At that time in Guadeloupe, you didn't mix. Blacks went with blacks, mulattoes with mulattoes, white Creoles went their own way, and the good Lord was content in heaven. Luckily, the children did not bother too much with grown-ups' business. We lived on good terms with the Driscolls of our own age, however mulatto they may have been, and Gilbert could have been my first boyfriend. He was a somewhat frail little boy with curly hair like an Arab street urchin's. His shyness contrasted with the behavior of his rough-and-tumble brothers. I had never heard the sound of his voice, and I imagined it wafting over the hills like a flute. We first met at catechism during an Easter retreat with 60 other children. Ever since, we conveyed our feelings by casting adoring looks at each other for hours on end from our respective balconies. On Thursday mornings, we kept a low profile because our families crowded onto the balconies. Madame Driscoll rested her weary bones in a chaise lounge or else cradled the latest newcomer to the family. My sisters dug their embroidery needles into linen table sets. The Driscoll boys did their homework, but in the afternoons it became too hot to stay out among the potted plants. Everybody retreated for their siestas and lowered the persienne. The little market at the corner finished its business for the day. The local shops closed up, and the only person left wandering in the streets was a madman nicknamed Banjo because of his bulging hernia. My mother, in a cotton shift, already resting under her mosquito net, impatiently called out, "Come in, for goodness sakes. What are you doing out in the sun like a sheep being bleached?" I didn't budge. Gilbert, however, put on sunglasses, covered his head with an old hat, or shaded himself under a parasol. As for me, I didn't dare move for fear of arousing suspicion, and I stoically continued to sweat profusely under the hammering sun. After months of risking sunburn, Gilbert grew bolder. Unlike me, who had told nobody, he confided in his best friend Julius, one of Evely's brothers. I had recently fiddled with Julius's weenie, amazed at the way it stiffened between my fingers, but there was never any pretense of a deeper attachment. It was just a game and a physical initiation. One late afternoon, Julius managed to outwit prying eyes and slip me an envelope. It contained an amazing photo. At first sight, it appeared to be a picture of a dog, a huge Alsatian sitting on its hind legs, jaws wide open and tongue hanging out. Then in the left-hand corner, I made out Gilbert, bare-chested, so tiny he looked like an elephant boy beside his charge. The photo must have been taken 2 or 3 years earlier, and he can't have been more than 6 years old. His bangs down to his eyes, he was smiling with a toothless grin. On the back of the photo, he had written the magic words, "I love you." I hid my treasure in a small wicker basket underneath my stuff for church, the only place my mother did not regularly inspect. Then I racked my brains thinking, what could I give him in exchange? My family had a preference for group photos, the 8 children between Mama and Papa, or else my brothers with my fathers or my sisters and me around my brother. There was no picture of me alone, not even with a dog. So what could I give him? A handkerchief I had embroidered, a shell I had painted, a raffia belt I had woven? I was hopeless with all 10 fingers. I collected zeros for manual work. I ended up choosing a tortoiseshell barrette my mother used to adorn my hair with. Now that his love had been officially declared and approved, Gilbert sent me a letter by the same messenger. At first sight, nothing extraordinary. It was written on pretty blue stationery in a firm hand, no ink blobs. As homework, the strictest of teachers would have marked very neatly written. I began to read with beating heart, but it stopped at the very first line. "My darling Maryse, you are the loveliest of them all with your blue eyes." I thought I had misread. Blue eyes? Me? I ran to the bathroom and looked at myself in the mirror. Undeniably, my eyes were dark brown, not even light brown, almost black. I returned to my room and sat down on the bed. I was troubled. It was as if I had read a letter meant for someone else. Throughout dinner, I was so unusually glum and silent that someone remarked, "Good Lord, is that child coming down with fever?" I went back to my room and reread the letter. The wording hadn't changed. "My darling Maryse, you are the loveliest of them all with your blue eyes." This time, I did not want to confide in Sandrino, who I knew would burst out laughing and treat me to one of those convoluted explanations he was good at. But what had happened? Had Gilbert taken a good look at me? Had he wanted to make fun of me? Was he trying to be clever? I was so angry that when Julius came back for an answer, I handed him a note with a pompous phrase found in one of my sister's favorite romance novels. "Gilbert, it is over between us." I had no idea I was committing the same fatal mistake as Gilbert. I was copying. I was copying out of a cheap novel. To venture into the unknown terrain of love letters, Gilbert had probably sought some kind of reference. Alas, our references were French pulp novels. For fear of catching sight of him on the following days, I did not go out to the balcony and remained holed up inside. He did not give up immediately. I ran across him one afternoon on the sidewalk outside Yves-Lys. He had his best friend in tow to give him courage. I had never been so close to him. He had combed his hair and splashed himself with Jean Marine Farina cologne. I realized he had big, sad gray eyes. "What did I do to you?" he murmured in a languishing voice. But the sound of his voice was not what I had expected. It didn't match its slender body. It was a gruff voice, almost a grown-up's. I was to remember it years later. I remained speechless. I rushed into Yves and burst into tears on her shoulders, telling her the whole dismal episode.
This is much further on in the book, towards the end, when Maryse is getting ready to leave Guadeloupe and leave her parents and her mother, whom she will never see again. So at the same time, it's a kind of chapter on freedom and also a great poem on nostalgia as well. Free at last. For my 16th birthday, my parents gave me a bicycle, a moto bécan, a pretty blue bike with silver mudguards that put wings on me. The stay at Dolé-les-Bains made me want to unlock the cage I had been in ever since I was born. I realized that I did not know my own island. I realized that all I knew of La Pointe was a narrow rectangle. As I was becoming increasingly rebellious, my parents understood they had to allow me room to breathe. At the age of 78, my father had practically lost his eyesight. Although invisible threads guided him as long as he remained inside the house, once he was outside, his vision blurred. He could neither cross the street nor find his way home. Since my mother had lost patience with him, he would go off to Sarcelles, the only place where he felt at peace, and like a wild man of the woods, would go for days without washing or a change of clothes. As for my mother, she had taken a turn for the worse. After a bad bout of flu, she had lost most of her hair and stuck poorly made postiches as black as ink on her head, and these clashed with the rest of her thinning salt and pepper hair. Her religious devotion reached new levels, which Sandrina's death less than a year later only accentuated. She missed neither dawn mass, high mass, low mass, sung mass, nor vespers, rosary, tenebrae, stations of the cross, or the month of the Virgin Mary. She made novenas, penance, fasts, rolled the beads of her rosary, took confession as well as communion. When she was not deep in devotion, she quarreled with me. For absolutely no reason, for absolutely nothing. I can't remember why we constantly squabbled. I can only remember I always had the last word. I lashed out at her with my sharp tongue, and she invariably ended up in tears, sobbing, "You're a viper." Alas, the feeling of empowerment I had when I was 10 had vanished. These tears had become a daily, commonplace sight that no longer drew compassion. My early years had been bathed in sunlight from my brothers and sisters, secretly in revolt against my parents. My adolescence was tinged with the colors of old age. I found myself alone with two antiquated individuals whose moods I did not understand. There reigned a morbid atmosphere in the house. The third floor had been sealed off, doors and windows nailed shut since nobody lived there anymore. I wandered miserably through a series of empty rooms, once Thérèse's and Sandrino's. I leafed through books, gathering dust on the shelves. I opened cupboards where old clothes still hung. I sat on beds with sagging mattresses. It was as if I were roaming a graveyard in remembrance of those I had lost. Sandrino had just been admitted to the Salpêtrière Hospital. My mother had convinced herself his illness was benign, but she guessed the outcome. She did not have the strength to make the journey to France, and the thought of him there was killing her. Thérèse, on the other hand, was taking her revenge. Her letters were short and few and far between. She had married a medical student from Africa who was the son of a reputed doctor in his own country. Yet my parents, so prestige conscious, disapproved. Even as a child, Thérèse's doings had never met with their approval. And then Africa was too far away, on the other side of the earth. My mother spoke of ingratitude and selfishness. She had not even bothered to put the photos of little Aminata on the piano, even though she was her first granddaughter. At 15, I looked at myself in the mirror and found myself ugly, ugly as sin. Stuck on the top of a lanky body was a melancholic, taciturn face, hooded eyes, untidy, skimpy hair, lucky front teeth, but not a sign of any good luck. The only saving grace was a skin of velvet that acne had dared not attack. Boys no longer turned their heads in my direction, which pained me because I had started to appreciate handsome specimens of the male species. Gilbert Driscoll had been transformed into a dandy with brilliantined hair, parading around his young girlfriends in the neighborhood. Friends were as scarce as admirers since Ivelisse had left school to go to work for her father. We no longer saw each other, and my mother badmouthed her behind her back, claiming she had men and would soon be saddled with a belly. At the lycée, where I was more uppity than ever, teachers and students alike were scared of me. Isolated, I sharpened my barbs like arrows that I hurled at everyone. As I was about to sit for my second baccalaureate a year in advance, I appeared the incarnation of intelligence combined with spitefulness. Once I possessed my motu bécane, I did not need anyone. I no longer bothered my head about my reputation. I pedaled and pedaled, soon venturing outside La Pointe. I discovered the low, swampy shoreline of Vieux-Bourg at Mont-Nalou, half covered with muddy seawater, and its mangrove inhabited by wader birds, all dressed in white. I pedaled in the other direction, towards Badiou-Fort, and the spectacular sight of the tall, chiseled limestone cliffs and the golden sands I had never had the chance to see before. As for beaches, I only knew Viard with its black, volcanic sand, like the dirty nails of an unwashed foot. Three or four times during the long school holidays, we would spend the day there, my mother decked out in an ensemble handmade by her seamstress, Jeanne Repentir, my father wearing long underpants and immodestly bearing the white hair on his chest. A servant woman hired for the season from Petit Bourg would heat up the Colombo curry on a fire amid four stones, and we would picnic under the wild almond trees. Sometimes one of the locals would prowl around and peer at this family tableau with curiosity. I lay for hours on the sand, wide-eyed, grimacing under the scorching sun. I longed to plunge into this great expanse of blue. Sandrino had taught me how to swim, a bit like a dog, but I didn't have a swimsuit. This item of apparel appealed only much later in my wardrobe, and I had grown too big for the petit bateau panties I used to wear. After the Badiou-Fort, I ventured farther, as far afield as Le Gosier. I had already read Virginia Woolf's To the Lighthouse. I was no longer inventing stories and made up for it by avidly reading everything I could lay my hands on. So I stared at the little island anchored a few cables' length from the shore and transformed it into a literary object, intertexture of dream and desire. Once I struggled as far as Sainte Anne, in those days, a peaceful little village undisturbed by tourism. I slumped down on the beach, sitting cross-legged beside me, impervious to my strange expression. The fishermen joked while mending their nets. The market women were selling skewers of tench and blue marlin to their customers. Children as black as tar were swimming naked. I dozed off, mouth open, and awoke to find dusk was falling. All around me, the beach was deserted and the tide was up. As a rule, I tried to be home before nightfall. This was the first time I had let darkness creep up on me. I was scared, scared of the winding road, scared of the shape of the houses, suddenly transformed into she-devils, scared of the menacing trees and the banks of raggedy clouds. So I sped home in a frenzy, my knees touching my chin, leaning flat out on the handlebars. And without understanding why, the speed went to my head. I felt free, full of the freedom I was soon to enjoy. Within a year, I would leave Guadeloupe, separated from my parents, whom I had never left for more than 2 weeks. The prospect both exalted and terrified me. What was I going to study? I felt no calling. My teachers had destined me for the preparatory classes of France's elite schools. In other words, I would be back at the Lycée Fénelon. This meant leaving one prison for another. And yet beyond the jail they intended me for, I could catch a glimpse of open doors I would squeeze through. When I arrived out of breath at the Rue Alexandre Isaac, my mother was waiting for me in the living room. She began her imprecations. What was I doing racing around like crazy under the sun? Wasn't I ugly enough and black enough as I was? I looked like a Congo girl. If it was a man I was looking for, I was wasting my time. I swept past her without a glance and locked myself in my room. She went on prattling. After a while, she ran out of breath and words and struggled up to the second floor, for she was increasingly racked with the arthritis she has left me with. I could hear her bump into the furniture and climb into her bed, which creaked like a boat being put to sea. Under the deceptive colors of pity, all the love I had for her surged into my heart and almost suffocated me. I went into her room without knocking, which was forbidden. Lying in the middle of her bed, she was propped up against a pile of pillows, for she complained of breathlessness during the night. Her prayer book lay open in front of her. She had removed her postiche, and there were bare patches on her scalp. She was old and alone. My father had left for Sarcelles at the beginning of the week, alone and old. I climbed onto the bed like I used to do when I was small, when nothing was refused me, when nothing was out of bounds. I hugged and hugged her and showered her with kisses. Suddenly, as if a signal had been given, we both began to cry for the beloved Sandrino who was dying so far away, for the end of my childhood, for a certain life we knew was over, for happiness of sorts. I slipped my hand between her now withered and useless breasts, which had breastfed 8 children, and we spent the whole night together, her clinging to me, and I curled up against her side amidst the smell of old age and arnica, lost in her warmth. That is how I want to remember her.
As I said, I absolutely adore this book. I think it's just a very precious book. Maryse and I did an interview about 2 years ago, which, 2 years? UNESCO. Was it 2 years ago? Or less than that. Right. Because last year, Maryse invited me along with several other Caribbean writers from the different languages, you know, from the Spanish-speaking, French-speaking. I don't think we had any Dutch-speaking. Because Maryse wanted us to come together, and I want to recognize Edwige Danticat, who's here. She was along. She came. And Maryse brought us together for a week to discuss the question of what is Caribbean literature. It was a phenomenal week of readings. We read, we ate a lot of food, and we had discussions, and you know, with people from the community, all sorts of people from the academy, but. One of the things that happened, I said to Maryse when I was doing this interview for UNESCO, the first question I asked her was something that struck me when I went to Guadeloupe. I am from Trinidad, and we have had our independence since 1962. So I told her that I was struck with white policemen in Guadeloupe, and the restaurants we went to, one in particular, the waiters were white. The chefs I could see behind were white. The people at the door, everybody that served you from French. Well,
they
French.
Were white,
They were not white, they were French. But the police really, they really got me, you know. I mean, I can understand it if I'm in the United States, but I was in a Caribbean island. So I asked her, what was it like growing up in Guadeloupe, and how did that feel? And so she'll answer that question.
It seems to me that the whole book, Tales from the Heart, is a kind of way of explaining what it is to be a child growing up in Guadeloupe. Because the French are not, as I said just now, they are not ordinary white people. The French have a policy which is assimilation. So they make you believe that if you are good, if you are well behaved, if you study well in class, you can become exactly like us, like them. But of course, it is not true at all. So you spend your time trying to imitate them. But at the last minute, they never entirely accept you. So you see, you are always dreaming about something that you will never get. The desire to become a French person is a myth. You will never. At the last minute, the French will find something which is wrong with you, and they will let you down. But anyway, you are living in the belief that maybe one day they will accept you. So for a child, it is something very, very challenging. Of course, when you get to a certain age, you understand full well that, after all, why do you try to imitate the French? Let them be. But I mean, before you come to that kind of sagesse, years pass by. So I mean, it was hard to be a child in a place like Guadeloupe, because we had to forget everything which was Caribbean, the music, the rhythm, the food, the language, everything which was Caribbean, and try to behave like those people who at the end never accepted us. So it was a kind of trauma. And it seems to me that up to now, I'm still suffering from that trauma. Not severely, but anyway, it is still there. So I don't know what the answer.
Yes. Well, I think I remember one other question I asked her that I was very interested in. As those of you who have read Maryse's books know that she's written a lot about Africa. So, and that she spent a lot of time in Africa. And I asked her, was that an alternative? How was that as an, did she go to Africa in reaction to this, to sort of to find a sense of identity? What did Africa mean to her there and in her work?
It seems to me that we shall need maybe a week, a month, a year to explain, to answer. But let's say that at the beginning, Africa was a way of displeasing my family. First my sister and then myself, two daughters going to marry African men. It was too much for them. They were really overwhelmed. So it was a kind of way of hurting them, making them furious and annoyed. But when I was in Africa, living there, I discovered Africa. It took me time to discover Africa, and it became a part of myself. It seems to me that if I had not been to Africa, lived there, and suffered the way I suffered in Africa, I would not be who I am now. Is that clear?
Yes. I want to invite you to ask Maryse some questions if you have them, or I can ask another one, but I ask it. My other one is coming real out of blue. This didn't happen in our interview. I went back to Guadeloupe. I loved that week we spent so much that I went back to Guadeloupe for 2 months last summer. And I stayed with this family who gave me a lot of writings by Maryse, not necessarily her novels, but articles she had written, because she'd written a lot of articles in the newspaper. One of them that I was struck with was the articles you wrote about Hugo, the hurricane Hugo. And they showed me all these photographs, but I was very interested in Maryse's article on Hugo. She wrote that that the United States and England sent planes full of food and medicine for the Guadeloupeans after the hurricane, but that France turned them back. Did I read that? Did I get that wrong? I think so. I think you said that.
Yes, because France wanted to be, as they always do in France, they wanted to be the only people helping us and giving what we needed. So, I mean, coming from England, coming from America was no good at all. They wanted to use Hugo as a way of strengthening the relationship, the bond, which is between Guadeloupe and France. So even in a catastrophe, that the only people to help and salvage were the French. Yeah. It was basically said.
I did read that. Yeah. And you know, I was in Martinique last week for the conference on Caribbean writers, women writers and scholars, and the statue of Josephine in the town in Fort-de-France had been cut off, decapitated, and somebody had put red blood, painted red all down front, so we didn't know where that was going to lead to.
We don't have Josephine.
No.
Josephine is a Martinican product.
Right. I want to open the questions, the floor. Yes.
If I went back to the theater, yes, I wrote a long play, kind of epic, based on a historical event which happened in 1802. So it was supposed to be played, performed this year in May. Unfortunately, Guadeloupe being Guadeloupe, we did not find the money for that, and we decided that it is going to be performed next year. So it is a play on a hero, a Guadeloupean hero, somebody who died against the reestablishment of slavery by Napoleon Bonaparte. But being what I am, who I am, I could not accept to write a play about a hero. So I had to find what is wrong in that man. So it became a kind of play where I make a lot of fun about that man. So fortunately, we have only a year to wait, so I don't know how it is going to be accepted. But it is going to be certainly performed next year. Yeah. So it is a very loaded question. We have been fighting about the question of language for, let's say, the beginning of time. Formally, there was a kind of dichotomy in the Caribbean, in the French Caribbean. People who write in Creole, people who compose in Creole, are the true nationalist people, the true Guadeloupean or Martinican. People who write in French are totally traitors to the culture. They are stooges, French puppets. I used to believe that. And in fact, I had a kind of confusion writing in French. But fortunately, at the same time, I'm a scholar, so I discovered Michael Bakhtin and what he's saying about a language. And he says that a language becomes the language of the person who knows how to use it. If you know how to use a language, if you know to express yourself in a language, it is yours. The language that Maryse Conde used has nothing to do with the language that the French people of France, colonial masters use. It is my language, a black person with a different history and a different past. So that kind of liberated me. And it seems to me that now I have the right to speak in French, but the French which should bear all the traces of my origin, a French which should be modeled against the rhythm, the color, the sounds, the metaphors of Guadeloupe. That is to say, a French which implies the complexity of a different culture. Of course, that is my solution. I write French now without any complex, and I don't believe at the same time that by writing French, I'm closer to the French. It happened. We share language, we talk together and so on, but I mean, when I write, the language I use is my own invention. It has nothing to do with anybody else. So that is the way I come to a kind of calm and, yes, balance about the use of language.
And
talk to she. Can you hear me?
No, could you come to the.
So about the bluest eyes, you mentioned that this researcher interviewed, was talking to children in a public school and told them, write something about your mother. And that all the children came back with this little essay saying, my mother is white and this and that. And he said, but I said, write about your mother. And what you say is the answer, you said right. So I've been thinking about that because it's interesting. And can you talk a little more about this decalage between, I mean, if they could talk about their mother as she really is, but when it comes to writing, they couldn't write that.
Let me try to remember the anecdote. There is a man, comment s'appelle le fou qui habite à Capestea? There is a man in Guadeloupe, I forgot the name, I can't find the name. But that man, who is a political man, was the first to lay his fingers on the alienation that the young people in Guadeloupe learn from their childhood. In a village of Guadeloupe, a school teacher asked the boys and girls of about 8 or 9 or 10, give a description of your mother. And all the kids said, my mother is fair, long hair, blue eyes, and so on and so. And so when he came back on the following day, he asked the children, but are you totally mad? Your mother is not fair. She's not white. She has no blue eyes. Are you mad? Don't you see your mother every day at home? And the children said, yes, we see our mothers, but we don't talk about them. You see, right. Meaning that if you write, you have to borrow the tradition, the framework of the colonial power, of the master of the language. So if you write, you should not write, you cannot write about somebody who is fat, who is black, who is heavy and so on. You should write about the models that you have in French literature. So Laureate. So Laureate was the first to publish a book where he collected all those anecdotes to show how children are being alienated from a very young age. And the stories that Elizabeth read was a kind of continuation of that. Gilbert, as a boy, he was about 12 or 14, 12, and myself as a girl, we were so deep into the French models and narratives that we could not imagine that somebody you are in love with could be black and have black eyes and a kinky hair. So of course, he had to write a letter, Maryse with your blue eyes, and myself, when I was replying to him, I said, Gilbert, it's over, j'ai fini avec toi. So you see, copying the French models. So I come back to Carla's question. In fact, writing a book for a French Caribbean is not only a question of language. It is not only finding a language which is your language, but it is even finding a structure which is your structure, a narrative technique, which is your narrative technique, something that you have not borrowed from Balzac, Stendhal, Flaubert, and so on. They are great writers, but they are not French Caribbean. So if you want to be a French Caribbean writer, you have to invent your language, your technique, and of course, you have to have a topic. But it is even less important because anybody can have a topic. And in fact, you can use a French topic to show how different you are as far as language and technique is concerned. So, I mean, finding a voice and finding a way in which you are going to express yourself. Am I clear, Noël?
I'm afraid we have to make that the last question. Thank you very much for coming out. We have some books out there, which I'm sure Maryse would be very happy to autograph for you. And there are some refreshments. And Natasha has one thing to tell you here about our next program. And again, thank you very much for coming. And I want to thank Maryse. And also to thank Jayne Cortez for coming and introducing Maryse.
Just a little bit of information. There is a sign-up list in the back if you're interested in being on our mailing list. There are wonderful posters, which is the cover from Tales from the Heart, which are available and free for everyone. I also wanted to let everyone know there are two upcoming events. There's a flyer for Tuesday, April 30th, the Langston Hughes event, which will be sponsored by Penn as well as other poetry organizations in New York. It will be at Town Hall. And Open Book will be presenting our final event for the year on June 15th at the Brooklyn Museum of Art. It's a Saturday. It's free and open to the public. There will be five readers, Nelly Rosario, Victor de Laval, Joy Harjo, Mina Alexander, and Luis Francia. So please, once again, thank you so much for coming and sharing this evening with us. And please sign up in the back. There are books that are available to be sold. Maryse will sign some books for you. Have a good evening.
Hi, how are you? Hi, nice to see you.